Good afternoon, and welcome to this presentation. It's my pleasure being here with you this afternoon. My apologies that we have to switch to English language, but my Spanish is not that advanced. So I will speak this afternoon for the next 25 minutes on the GCC market overview opportunities, and for the sake of the time and the massive information which we try to cover, I will focus on the clean tech sector. And even within this sector, I try to concentrate on the two major markets, which is the UAE and Saudi Arabia, for that matter. So let me kick off by a quick economic overview of the GCC countries. GCC stands for Gulf Cooperation Council, which is a political organization which was formed in 1981 in Abu Dhabi. And like I mentioned, it's more sort of a political union. They have tackled also some economic cooperation issues, such as a custom union. But they had, when they founded, probably bigger goals, also in terms of having a common currency, but this never really materialized. So it's sort of more political cooperation between the Gulf countries. And if you have a look at the population and the GDP, it's easy to recognize that you have Saudi Arabia by far being the largest player in the GCC. In terms of GDP, they have by themselves a larger GDP than the combined other five nations together. So you can clearly speak from Saudi Arabia being the powerhouse in the region. And this also reflects in the population. So you have a relatively small population of some of the smaller states, as much as small as 1.3 million for Bahrain, followed by Oman, by Qatar, Oman, and Kuwait. But Saudi Arabia being with almost 30 million, the largest market in the region. And this is important to notice. The UAE has been quite anonymous with the project sector. So many businesses usually generated not necessarily by the fact that it's a large population, but by the fact that there's a huge project sector in the construction sector, and that the hospitality sector, meaning the tourism sector, is also prevailing in the UAE. If it comes to consumer goods, Saudi Arabia is the largest market to look at and to consider for that purpose. You've seen Qatar at the end of the table being in red color. That is a certain reason. You all have heard about the crisis, Qatar crisis, and it's. I have to put some question marks whether Qatar will, if I do the presentation in 1 or 2 years, still be part of the GCC. So there's talks about them possibly also exiting this political union. And speaking of Qatar, and I would like to point out the two major developments which happened in the last year. I'm in the region since 1999, and I have to say I was surprised by the developments which happened in terms of Qatar in June of last year. I will come to that in a minute, so I would briefly like to touch on this. And the other major development in the region is the reforms which are going on in Saudi Arabia, which are very closely linked to the person in the picture, Mohammed bin Salman, or shortly MBS, who is really spearheading these developments and the reforms that are currently happening in Saudi Arabia. Quickly to the Qatar crisis, I mentioned we all woke up on the 5th of June of last year to the news that Qatar, the UAE, basically severed their diplomatic ties with Qatar, which really reminded me of the medieval siege of a fortress or so, what happened afterwards, because all the roads from Saudi Arabia were cut, which basically meant that all the supply lines were cut to Qatar, and that really led to the pictures which you might have all seen, empty supermarkets, and so that they had on the short term a supply issue, and they had to tackle with the issue that many agricultural products were coming from Saudi Arabia or being imported to Saudi Arabia, and they had to quickly find a substitution to that. But it's not only that, it's also the flight connection which have been cut, and beyond this is also the exchange between the countries. There have been a lot of cultural exchange, a lot of families were rooted in both of the countries, and after this diplomatic action, it also meant that all Qataris, Qatari nationals, had to leave the UAE, Saudi Arabia, and Bahrain within a time frame of 2 weeks. So that were quite some drastic action. What happened then is what I sort of compare with the Berlin situation after the Second World War. A lot of supplies were basically airlifted into Qatar, and so who came to the rescue was Turkey and Iran, who helped in the short term of supplying goods to Qatar. But Qatar now is basically in the processing of realigning all their ties, economic ties with their former, in the absence of the former friends and partners which they had. And this is a market opportunity for companies to get into this sort of vacuum. What this actually practical business means is if you want to now reach Doha from Dubai, you will have to travel via Kuwait or Muscat. What was formerly a one-hour trip has become now almost a day's journey. It's 6-7 hours to basically fly from Dubai to Qatar, which made it quite complicated. The other development, which I briefly like to touch on and which we obviously cannot ignore, is the development in developments in Saudi Arabia, which is, as I mentioned earlier, very closely linked to Mohammed bin Salman, the crown prince. When he started his role, he was a deputy crown prince. Now he's the crown prince. And I wouldn't be surprised if within 1 or 2 years he will be the future king of Saudi Arabia. So he's a 37-year-old character. He's the youngest minister of defense globally, and he is the power basically behind all these reform efforts. And in Saudi Arabia, there have been, you know, a lot of, in the past, a lot of efforts to reform the economy and sort of modernize the economy, diversify the economy, which has been succeeded to a certain extent, but it has never been really pushed forward with this intensity. And now we feel with Mohammed bin Salman that there's a now or never attitude. So he has to make it work. And the good thing is that he has the support, especially of the younger population, and this is the majority of the population. There's some grumbling if you speak to Saudis, especially the older generation. It's all going too fast for them also. So they say we have to take it step by step, but with the younger generation behind him, he might be able to succeed. So Mohammed bin Salman, he was behind many initiatives. One notably already going on for a few since 2 years is the IPOing of Saudi Aramco. So he is the one pushing for that. So by the end of the year, we will have a 5% IPO of Aramco, the world's largest oil company on the international stock market, which might fetch Saudi Arabia up to $100 billion with this IPO. But there's also more to that. It's also a very consequent crackdown of some of the issues which were there in Saudi Arabia, which is corruption. So he is really head-on tackling this. And you might have heard of the fact that the Ritz-Carlton in Saudi Arabia has actually been transformed to a luxury prison, I would call it, and more than 150 officials have been kept there. And now, just lately, you know, most of them have been released. And these have been also very prominent figures. Prince Walid was among them. He was having his residency now in the Ritz-Carlton for more than 2 months until a settlement has been reached also with him, and things have been cleared. But other than the fight against corruption, which is going through all the positions, nobody really has been spared. So Prince Walid is one example, but also former ministers, former head of the National Guards. So everybody has been involved. So it's not only the small fish, but also the big fish, which basically have been caught there. And the other is other economic reforms which are taking place, which is mostly all about pushing the private sector, encouraging the private sector, and I come to this a little later on. The other issue which should be noted is the growing role of the women in Saudi Arabia. So this is really a big change that's happening there for Saudi Arabia. Women now being allowed to drive, being allowed to start business without the approval of a male relative, and so on and so forth. And also the cultural scene is all shifting. Cinemas will be allowed, and so a lot of, I think we will see a lot of interesting developments out of Saudi Arabia. Quick look at Saudi Arabia. These are just some information or some general statistics on Saudi Arabia. You see the government budget deficit at a quite high level, and this was obviously combined with the low oil prices, which have been as low as $30 in the past year, was also one of the main driving factors for initiating all these reforms in Saudi Arabia. And I mentioned the largest economy in the MENA region, one of the top 20 economies worldwide, and a very fast-growing, one of the fastest-growing countries. They try to push the GDP per capita from currently 25,000 to 33,000 until 2020. Traditionally, Saudi per capita income has been on a rather lower end compared to their Gulf neighbors. For example, the GDP of UAE is 37,000, of Qatar even 54,000. So that is something going on. And all the reforms which I mentioned on and which MBS is embarking on is really enshrined into the Vision 2030, which has obviously different elements to it. But it's all basically evolving around the fact that increase of non-oil government revenues, increase of the private sector contribution to the GDP, getting more effective, pushing the e-government initiatives in Saudi Arabia, attract more foreign direct investment, and also doing sort of the cultural shift, which I explained earlier. Now, I just like to take a quick look at the UAE. You saw that in the initial chart, which I showed, the second largest economy in the GCC. You saw a slightly larger budget deficit of last year, which also has to do with the fact that the diversification in the UAE has started much earlier than in Saudi Arabia, and the dependency on oil is not that large as not to that extent like it is in Saudi Arabia. And the activities in the UAE, so they already are quite advanced in the compared to the other Gulf countries when it comes to diversification of the economy and the attraction of FDI. Now they like to focus on the educational sector and promoting innovation and entrepreneurship. Now, entrepreneurship has been there for a long time, but now it's all about innovation and being on the cutting edge of innovation and technology. That's the reason why there are a lot of government sponsors program when it comes to setting up incubators and really trying to encourage and attract this innovation aspects of businesses. Just recently, there's been a government summit, and all the main topic of the summit was all about artificial intelligence and players in that sector. So this is really the way they like to go to. Speaking of Dubai, I obviously also have to mention the Expo 2020 project, which is one of the most prestigious projects in the UAE. It's the first time that the Expo takes place in an Arab country or in the Middle East. So when Dubai was awarded, it was a really big thing for them, also symbolically. And now they obviously put all their resources in making the Expo 2020 a success. And again, there's a construction aspect of this, and I have a short video to share with you after this. But it's also to understand the Expo 2020 mindset. Dubai has been a transit country. A lot of people have been transiting through Dubai or the UAE, but it's and a lot of business have been setting up there. But now it's now also they focus, and this is the main theme of the expos, really bringing minds together or sharing ideas. And this is what how Dubai would like to position itself. Also, it's like an international place where people come together and connect. Now, with the expo 2020 only being 31 months away, obviously the construction is going on. I have to say. Just a few months back, I would 6 to 8 months back, there was not much visible on the ground, really, and we have visited it. So now we are feeling now it's really, the construction is starting full steam, and this obviously also offers a lot of opportunities for companies to get involved in this. So this is just some a short video on the current status of the construction, 31 months before that. And you see this is the metro line, the metro extension that is reaching to the Expo 2020 site. So currently we have the infrastructure developments, roads, public transports, and everything related to that. And then we have the actual pavilions as part of the Expo 2020 site. So you see it's already pretty good in progress. This is a sustainability pavilion. One of the, besides mobility, sustainability will be one of the main themes of the Expo 2020 in Dubai. And I would like to encourage you to visit also the Expo 2020 website, which you can see on the bottom part of this slide. There's also one link to tenders, which are being floated. So it's all public tenders, which you can take a look at that are related to the Expo 2020. You can register yourself as a company. More than 50 or 17,000 companies have already registered for that. Now, I'd like to shortly touch on the clean tech sector as one of the sectors, prominent sectors in the Middle East. And for me, the clean tech sector, being in this region for quite some time, I've seen a very important mind shift with regards to the clean tech sector. Whereas 5-8 years ago, people would have seen it rather as a sort of, they would have smiled at it, but rather have, as an oil producing country, rather would have perceived this as a potential threat to them. But this has completely changed. Now the renewable energies are being embraced, and also the governments and all the institutional players realize that they have a very strategic location and also opportunities and advantages in the global scenario when it comes to renewable energies in that field. And so the GCC market, most of the tenders are being floated by public institutions. So usually the projects are developed in stages, and each phase or each stage is being tendered separately. And what we have seen is very low. The prices have come down here for the CSP projects. These were globally the lowest prices for the kilowatt unit, which have been achieved for a project in Dubai for the Mohammed bin Rashid solar park. Also potential application for the water or power itself. Most of the power is generated by diesel at the moment. So this is also, they are looking at replacing this, saving on diesel or on oil, and replacing this with renewables. Job creation is another thing which is related to that. But generally, I find this statistics, this factor quite interesting, that the objective is, and this is not only for the UAE, this is GCC-wide, that to produce 25% of their power by 2030 through renewable energy. So quite some way to go. A quick look at some of the players in that field. Masdar, they were really spearheading this is a renewable initiative. Masdar is based in Abu Dhabi. So they are the first ones adopting or making this shift and starting with projects, renewable projects, not only in the UAE, but also in neighboring countries and globally. I mentioned quickly the Mohammed bin Rashid solar park outside Dubai. By 2030, they are looking at generating up to 1,000 megawatt of energy through this park. IRENA is headquartered in Abu Dhabi. That was also quite a significant step. Shams is one of the projects which is being developed from Abu Dhabi. And then also I'd like to touch on the solar roof project, rooftop projects, which is initiated by DEWA, the Dubai Electricity and Water Authority. And this is also where the private households come in, where they have finalized a scheme, a feed-in tariff, where private households can also feed into the grid and get compensated for that. Next picture shows a few Spanish or bus companies being involved also in the Dubai Mohammed bin Rashid solar projects in different forms and shapes. And this is just a picture of a recent visit of the deputy minister to the Mohammed bin Rashid solar park. Same in Saudi Arabia, we also have very ambitious goals, 8.5 gigawatt generated by renewables up to 2030. And the drivers in Saudi Arabia, and this is actually also shows the change in the mindset, is Saudi Aramco, the largest oil company in the world, whereas they have adapted it, you know, some smaller projects some years ago, and you could argue that this was sort of a green phase initiative, but now they are really embracing it, and they are looking at generating up to 10% by renewables in the next 6 years. So this is a very potent big partner who's investing in clean technology and renewables in Saudi Arabia. The other is the King Abdullah City for Atomic and Renewable Energies Research Center, but which is also very active in the fields of renewables. Other subsectors in the renewable sector, I like to just briefly mention the waste management is one of the very booming sectors which sees a lot of business activities and where we have a lot of huge developments in the waste to energy projects. There are currently 3 to 4 large waste to energy projects going on in the UAE. And the other, for sure, the other sector is the sector of water treatment, everything water treatment, water conservation, which is obviously also a very important fact, given the situation that most of the water is scarce, obviously, in the desert, and that the most of the water is being produced by desalination plants. So I know I'm already a little bit behind. I just quickly like to talk about the major players. I already mentioned some of them. So it's usually the utility companies who are floating the larger tenders in the renewable sector, but then it's also research institutes and also private companies, which such as Aqua Power. It's a Saudi headquartered company, which has been very active in the region and has won quite a few projects in the renewable fields and could serve as a very important cooperation partner when it comes to implementing projects. Exhibitions to consider in that is the VETEX exhibition, sponsored by DEWA, the Dubai Electricity and Water Company, taking place in October in the World Future Energy Summit in Abu Dhabi, which is usually taking place in January. So these are potential trade shows to look at when you're thinking of engaging in the sector. And very quickly, 2 minutes to come to a close is how to get started. And I'm happy to share this slide with you later on. It's really understanding who are your customers in the UAE. And this is sort of more tailored now towards the renewables sector, municipality, utilities, the private sector, oil and gas. Then thinking about the distribution channels. What could be the right distribution channels for you? Again, if you're getting involved in the government projects, you would probably have to go with a local distributor, somebody registered locally and being able to assist you with the government projects, whereas for smaller projects, you might be able also to supply directly. How to find the right partner, make a short list, conduct your due diligence, consult legal entities, and go to work. That is also, I think, more or less the same in many export markets. So try to get as many information as possible. Events such as the Intergune obviously is a good platform, but also try to speak to your trade partners in the countries, visit trade shows, and most importantly also talk to customers. Once you have shortlisted potential distribution partners, make sure you have you engage into a conversation with them. Make sure you actually visit their offices, their facility. Make sure you align the strategy with them. Let them tell you what is their marketing strategy for you, or what do they propose. Let them come forward and proposing things to you, and then go through them together. Always the question, do you go with a big partner or a small company? It depends on the project, but it probably also depends on your size. That you probably want to be on the same eye level with the partners. So this is something that is quite sensitive, and you should spend a lot of time on carefully selecting the local partner for that matter. And then once you have agreed that, you have done your due diligence, we have done the legal work, then as post-agreement, go to work, and it's mostly visit, show physical presence, personal presence with a 3C client, consultant, and contractors, attend trade shows, and be visible in the market. That is very important. And with this, I would like to thank you and wish you good luck with your business endeavors in the Gulf. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Ritter.